This channel is part of the History Hit Network.
I used to come here a lot when I was a kid. I don't go to church anymore, though. I still read the Bible. Got this beautiful family Bible. I'm rather proud of it. It's got lists of my ancestors going back over hundreds of years. They've written their name. Look at this. Samuel Thomas, one of them was called. This book, in the year of 1746, my mother gave me this Bible. In fact, Samuel Thomas and his ancestors are all listed in the front of the book. Going right back to 1690, when they were married, when their children were born, when they were baptized, when their children died too, a lot of the time. It's the whole history of my family put in their most important book. This Bible was actually printed in the same century as the great English Bible, the King James Bible, the Bible where God is called Jehovah. And that's this Bible. Think of that. My family, they've been reading and listening to this Bible for hundreds and hundreds of years. Apart from its moral message, its very words must have seeped into them as they've seeped right through the English language. And of course, centuries before King James's Bible, Europe was using this book almost as its sanction, as the thing that gave order to the world and power to kings. It's the book of Christendom, the single book of Christendom. And it goes much further than that. It's not just the history of my family and what Europe's done with it, but this book reaches right back to the beginning of civilization, to the ancient Near East, where the oldest Bible stories took place. So that's the Bible story, then. It goes from the most ancient world right up to modern Europe. Let's start, like you would with most good books, let's start at the beginning. First great lines of the Bible. Genesis, chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was on the face of the deep. And in the next 7 days, Jehovah, we are told, creates the earth and everything in it. Well, is that literally true? I mean, was there somebody who knew that and then wrote that down in the Bible? Is it history? How do we take that? Well, when my ancestors were writing their names in this Bible in the 17th century, they had absolutely no doubt that that word was literally true and the word of God. There was an archbishop at that time who worked out, by chasing back the generations from Jesus right back to Adam, that the world had actually started in the year 4004 BC on a 13th of July on a Sunday night. Actually, that made chaos starting on a Saturday evening before, so that seemed pretty good to the 17th century. But I don't think really it seems very good to us anymore. I mean, even Bible scholars would point out that there's gaps in the generation from Jesus back to Adam, whether you believe in him or not. So we actually have to look at Genesis in a slightly different way to see what's going on, to see where those Bible beginnings are. Now, think of the landscape that Jehovah's creating in Genesis. He's creating a landscape where there are shepherds, men like Abraham, where there are sheep and rivers and cities, and you go on great long journeys, and you're a nomad and all this sort of thing. It's creating the world of the ancient Near East, just like the book of Genesis tells us. That's the world in which the Bible was born.
Terah took Abraham his son, and Sarah his daughter-in-law, his son Abraham's wife, And they went forth with them from Ur of the Chaldees to go into the land of Canaan. And they came unto Haran and dwelt there. And the days of Terah were 205 years, and Terah died in Haran.
Abraham's travels are a key to understanding the beginnings of the Bible. Just as the book of Genesis takes you on a grand tour of the ancient East, from the Garden of Eden, past the Tower of Babel, down into Pharaoh's Egypt, so Abraham's wanderings follow exactly the same route, past all the wonder and wisdom of the ancient world. The book of Genesis is filled with clues to tell us where and when this all took place. Abraham, it tells us, lived at Haran before he started his long trek south. Today, Haran is a well-known archaeological site in southeast Turkey, with a village lived in by nomads who settled down. Families, in fact, a bit like Abraham's.
The name Haran means crossroads. Haran stood, if you like, at the heart of the ancient world, at Piccadilly Circus. Look, 1,000 miles over there is the Persian Gulf. The two great rivers, the Tigris and the Euphrates, that drain into it, run up there somewhere and end up not too far away over there. Now, of course, all down the sides of those rivers are the greatest cities of the ancient world, the cities of Mesopotamia, the land of Sumer. The Bible calls it the land of Shinar. Over there is where Abraham's going to next. Canaan, Syria, and then down into Egypt. They're rough little places, though, Syria and Canaan at this time. Little sort of mountain towns, getting most of their culture from Mesopotamia. Egypt, of course, is a land on its own, doing its own thing quite happily. So you can see that when Abraham and his family and his herds were travelling, they weren't just wandering around aimlessly in the desert talking to God.
He was going down the ancient M1. He was travelling the whole arc of the Fertile Crescent, and it was a great trading route. You see, you went in boats mostly, but sometimes with donkeys along the rivers, and then you came round here and you went down into Canaan with your donkeys. You didn't go through the middle because there was a desert, and you and your donkeys would have died of thirst. Now, this is an interesting thing. Camels, which could cross that desert because they can go without water for about 3 days, came in about 600 BC. So those stories that describe Abraham riding a camel must have been made about that time. The phrase Ur of the Chaldees, too, it's an interesting phrase because the word Chaldea is a word for Mesopotamia over there, and that didn't come in till about 600 BC either. So it looks like those stories, at least in Abraham, date from around that time. But there are many other stories to do with Abraham which show that that sort of lifestyle is thousands of years older than that. Archaeologists have been coming up with evidence of Abraham for years. But you can't always trust them. Just because you dig up a place called Haran doesn't mean you dug up Abraham's house. And there's still no real evidence that the people in the book of Genesis ever lived at all. What archaeologists have given us, though, is an amazing amount of evidence about Abraham's ancient world. Of ancient Egypt and ancient Mesopotamia and all the rest. And that you can find at sites like Haran.
A western boundary for this ministry.
We know an incredible amount about Mesopotamian civilization, largely because we've been digging it up for 150 years. But you know, at the end of the day, when you found all the splendid palaces and the heaps of gold and the great statues and all the rest of it, the thing that really tells you is the writing, especially with Mesopotamia, because they lived in mud houses and they've all gone. Their writing survives. They invented writing. They wrote on tablets of clay like this one, polished up the surface with a beautiful shine. They got a little wedge-shaped stick, and with that, they impressed little patterns. Now, these patterns had started off as pictures, but they ended up as completely abstract signs called cuneiform. And they stamped out all their little words in rows in such a successful system that it went straight round the Fertile Crescent. It went from deep in Mesopotamia, right through here, through Haran, right down You can find it in the state archives of Egypt. And of course, if you invent a system of writing, even though it's taken up by dozens of languages, the style of your writing stays with you. So the Mesopotamian legal system, the legal contracts, became the legal norm for the whole of the ancient world. So Mesopotamian science and dating and all that, Mesopotamian culture came out of Mesopotamia, just like Abraham, on tablets like this. This actually is quite an interesting one. It's actually a land grant. It's a business contract. It tells you that Joe now owns his plot of land and he's bought it from Fred for so much money. Well, that's rather interesting because there's a passage in the book of Genesis where Abraham is buying a plot of land. Now, archaeologists dig those land grant tablets up by the city gates usually because that's where the documents were made out and the announcements, the public announcements of the change of property took place. And that's exactly what you find in the book of Genesis. But how vivid it is in Genesis. It tells you about Abraham, the man, buying the land in which he's going to bury his wife. And it's a lovely little story. This, of course, the Mesopotamian version is a very dry legal document, but they amount to the same thing. And if you look in those tablets, you'll find dozens of biblical customs. That lovely custom that Abraham and his family had of swearing oaths by putting their hand under their thigh. That's on these tablets too. Just as Isaac's dying words are taken as a written will in the Bible, so a man's dying words are taken as a written will in these Mesopotamian tablets when you read about the law courts and things like that. This is actually a list of Mesopotamian laws made about 1760 BC. And they're written out in just the same way as the list of Jehovah's laws in the Old Testament. And there's a Mesopotamian king receiving his laws from a god at the top of a mountain in just the same way that Moses received the Ten Commandments from his god on top of his holy mountain in the wilderness of Sinai. You know, great numbers of those Mesopotamian tablets are actually dated. The scholars have spent many, many years trying to fix Abraham and all his family into our modern history. Well, at present, those tablets, those old Mesopotamian tablets that deal with Abraham and his sort of lifestyle, date between 2500 BC and 500 BC. You can't really get much tighter than that. Perhaps they're older, who knows? But why is there this terrific obsession to put people like Abraham into our history? Remember, biblical history isn't like that. That deals in generations. You go from Adam to Jesus, and it's to do with a family. We want dates. Why do we want dates? I think some people think that if I could march up here and tell you Abraham lived in such and such a year, that would actually prove the existence of God. Think so? Or perhaps there are other people who actually think that it would be nice to believe that there was really a time on earth when there were people like Abraham, people that founded nations and talked to God when the world was a purer place. Of course, in most other religions, Abraham would himself have been a god, the founder, father of a nation, a man of mythic deeds. Well, what does Jehovah say? He says in the Bible, "You shall have no other God but me." And those Bible scribes have to make damn sure that Abraham is never allowed any of the attributes of any sort of a God at all. So he appears as Mr. Heavy Normal, Mr. Heavy Normal Shepherd, Mr. Banality. And that's what gives Genesis this extraordinary tension. It's a tension between myth on one side and the most ordinary thing on the other. Can I tell you something else too? You try and fix Abraham down in history, and he and his family will pick up their tents and they'll steal away over horizons that go on for thousands and thousands of years.
That's about as far as you'll get, looking for Abraham with a spade and a map. And yet, you know, you can't work for very long in the East, even in an age of motor cars and televisions, without feeling close to people like Abraham. They seem to be just out of reach. In the air, in the dust. It might not rate high on an archaeological list of candidates for the biblical city of Ur, but the city of Urfa, quite close to ancient Haran, has a lot of Abram's world in it. Something, too, that's more important than bricks and stones, Muslims who live here believe that their city is the city of Ur from which Abraham started his travels. They say that Abraham was born here in a cave, which is now a holy place with a holy spring of water. Abraham is counted as a prophet in Islam, the first man to proclaim that there is but one God. At Urfa, they say, he attacked the statues of the gods of the sun and the moon, that a wicked king imprisoned him and tried to burn him on a fire, but then, miraculously, the flaming logs of wood all turned to fine fat fish. The descendants of these fish still swim on at Urfa, in these great ponds, fed by the waters of Abraham's holy spring. The fish ponds are the heart of the city. Everyone walks here in the evenings admiring the fine fish. And God help you if you should kill one. These fish are still sacred, just as they have been for thousands upon thousands of years. Before the Muslims, there were the Christians here at Urfa. Before the Christians, Greeks, when the fish's fins were decorated with golden jewelry. Before the Greeks, there were the ancient Mesopotamians, when the fish swam about in honour of the moon god. So think about it for a minute, what you've got here. You've got this pool of sacredness. And the religions that have come and gone through the ages, they're sort of decorations to something much deeper. It's a sort of human awareness of sacredness that is here. And the theology is just, you know, different expressions of that basic idea. That is Abraham's world, that feeling that underneath everything in the world there is a sacredness. It's not a stupid world, it's not a daft world, it's not what idiots believe in. It's what the human race has made. It's one of the things that makes it different from the animals. It's a very important aspect. If you don't understand that, you will not understand the Bible and its beginnings. Look, before you had Orthodox religion as we know it today, I think the most ancient religions, you might say, were invented really by poets and artists. People came to places like Urfa and felt there was something sacred here. Artists made statues of gods, poets wrote hymns for them, and the priests organized the cult. If everybody felt that those statues, those hymns, or even these fish embodied something of the sacred, the god became a success. And he didn't, it just died out, and that was the end of it. Now, our Bible is a continuation of that, because what that is a definition of the sacred itself. You make a statue of a god, you're trying to define something of the quality of these fish in this marvelous pond. And our Bible is the world's most elaborate conception of a definition of the understanding of God himself. In ancient Mesopotamia, the world and all its gods was explained in sacred stories. These stories, of course, were myths. Myths, that is, not in the modern meaning of the word, as lies or falsehoods, but in the sense of a story that told of the underlying order of the world. Myths could explain the beauty of a spring or a fish, the mystery of a cave. They could explain your good fortune and your misfortune. They helped you feel secure, part of a sacred family, a universal order. Like all ancient people, Abraham would have seen his life in terms of myth. The people who made the Genesis creation story knew these old stories well. And they used some of them in their description of the beginning of the world. Like Abraham, the Bible story of creation was born in ancient Mesopotamia. Mesopotamia was very fertile, bountiful even, but it also held random violence in it. the Mesopotamians, life was precarious. Crops and cities were often parched or washed away by floods and violent storms. There was plague too, a tribesman raiding down from the surrounding hills. The Mesopotamian myth of the creation gave order to uncertainty. Enuma Elish, the ancient priests recited to them. Enuma Elish, la nabu shamanu. When, on high, the heavens were not yet named. They went on to tell an ancient, terrifying story of a family feud. How one day, the great mother goddess declared war on all six generations of her family because they were making too much noise. And then, the gods appointed Marduk, a warrior of the six generations, their champion. Marduk fought the mother goddess and her husband and her demon army on the great wide plain of Mesopotamia. And finally, he overcame them. As for the mother goddess, he pushed the wild wind into her mouth, bloated her stomach, shot arrows into her. Mesopotamia was born. With a butcher's knife, Marduk split the carcass of the mother goddess in half and made the sky and the earth. And from the arch of her thighs, he made the vault of heaven. Her head he buried under the northern mountains and pierced her eyes so that Mesopotamia's two great rivers would flow down her cheeks.
It's extraordinary to think of that terrible Mesopotamian mayhem. That terrifying story of creation is the same story that underlies that solitary, majestic creation of Jehovah
in the book of Genesis.
In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. It's the same story as that Mesopotamian murder. And that's important in a way. It's important, not because you say, oh, well, fancy that, you know, the book of Genesis is a rip-off of some Mesopotamian folk story. That's not the thing. It's important because what, through the Bible, that old Mesopotamian story has given the West, it's given the West a very particular model of the universe, of a certain sort of structure, of a single unit with stresses and strains in it, just like a family. Now, how these things work. How is it that the Mesopotamian story is buried in this first page of the book of Genesis? Well, you're not going to find some Mesopotamian god called Jove, who ends up being Jehovah, who goes off and does a similar thing in Mesopotamia. The concordance between the two stories is one of structure and number. Remember, there are six generations of Mesopotamian gods, just as Jehovah takes 6 days to make the universe. And at each day, Jehovah makes a part of the universe. He makes the sun, the stars, the silt, the animals, the plants, the birds. The Mesopotamian gods of each of those six generations are the gods of the exactly the same things that Jehovah is making of each of his 6 days of creation. So underneath this text, if you like, there live the Mesopotamian gods. Look, just start on the first day. God made the firmament and divided the waters which were under the firmament from the waters which were above the firmament. The waters below ground and above ground, salt water and fresh water. The waters, incidentally, are the two rivers of Mesopotamia going into the Persian Gulf. Mesopotamia going on here, but that is the gods of the first generation. The great mother goddess was the god of the salt water. Her husband was the god of the fresh water. They're the first generation gods. That's what he's making on the first day. And you can go like that. Second generation, second day, third generation, third day, fourth generation. And God made two great lights, the greater light to rule the day and the lesser light to rule the night. He's making the sun and the moon. What are the gods of the fourth generation of Mesopotamian gods? They're the gods of the heavens, of the sun, the moon, and the stars. And he made the stars also, the book of Genesis tells us, on the fourth day. And that correspondence goes right down through the list until you come to the sixth day. Now, what happens on the sixth day? Marduk, of the sixth generation of gods, makes man so that the other gods can rest. The other gods are building Marduk a temple. It's become so splendiferous, they're going to build the guy a temple. So Marduk takes pity on them and all and says, right, I'll make you a man a slave so that you can all rest. What does Jehovah do? He makes man on the sixth day, and then Jehovah takes the rest. The difference is with the sort of man that's being made. Marduk makes man to be a slave. Jehovah, though, makes man in his own image. Man is given responsibility. It's as if the people who wrote Genesis are saying, yes, we understand your world, Mesopotamia. We absolutely believe in the way you priests have divided up the whole order of the universe. You're good scientists, but you're lousy moralists. We want a different role for men. That means, too, they wanted a different role for God. So the God of Genesis isn't a Mesopotamian God. Where did he come from? Well, think of Abraham again. He's going on his intellectual journey. He's starting in Mesopotamia and he's going to Egypt. And the Jehovah of Genesis is not so much like the gods of Mesopotamia, but far more like the gods of Egypt.
Down to Egypt to look for Abraham and all his family to continue the intellectual journey of the book of Genesis, then leave the cinema behind you. Its vision of ancient Egypt, based on Victorian paintings like this one, is correct in all its detail but mistaken in its broad assumptions. Egypt never enslaved other nations. Nor did it build pharaoh's tombs with foreign slaves. This tells you a lot about the 19th century, but almost nothing about ancient Egypt. Let's start at the beginning. The book of Genesis tells us that the generations of Abraham, Joseph, Jacob, and Moses all went down into Egypt. But is there any scientific evidence of such foreigners ever living in Pharaoh's kingdom at all? At the archaeological site at Tel El Dabba in the Egyptian Delta, they've dug up the very town that such travellers would have seen when they'd first crossed the deserts to go down into Egypt.
You know, it's not very often these days that you can actually suddenly come across something completely new, which really verifies the truth of ancient history. So most of the ancient history we've got is built on a framework of ancient books themselves and, of course, the Bible. And it's very seldom you can come across something which actually seems to corroborate things that are going on in the Bible, major events that took place over hundreds of years. So this, in the Egyptian Delta, this strange little field, is one of the most important digs in the Middle East since the Second World War. Here, look, just like ordinary fields, right? But just down in front of me, that is real history. It's the sort of the thing that the ancient authors and the Bible itself was talking about.
It doesn't look much, does it? These few walls are going to be filled in again next year, and there'll be growing onions on here, and the archaeologists will be moving into the next field. At the moment, you can see the remains of a grain bin there from 1500 BC. Down there, a bit further, is a wall from a house of 2000 BC. That's the same time as that wonderful painting from Egypt which shows a family of foreigners arriving from Syria, from Canaan, in their wonderful robes, so reminiscent of the patriarchs and the descriptions of them in the Bible.
The reports of the Austrian archaeologists showed what modern science could make of what at first had seemed to be one of the most unpromising sites in Egypt. Under the little houses of ordinary people, in small graves, they found family treasures and the very bones of the foreigners, people like Abraham and Joseph, who had come down into Egypt. And at the dead men's feet, they even found the bones of the little horses that had carried them on their travels. What, then, did the ancient Egyptians think of all these foreigners that came down into Egypt? The same Egypt in which the Bible says Abraham and all his family should be included. The evidence is surprising and rather different from the attitudes you find in the Old Testament. The facts are best seen in Egypt's famous tomb paintings, like those in the 3,500-year-old tomb chapel of the vizier Rekhmire at Thebes.
Look at the amazing care and interest that the Egyptian artists showed when they looked at foreigners. How intrigued they were by them all. Here are black people from the south, and they're bringing tribute to the man who owned this tomb. What are they bringing? Logs of ebony, wild cheetahs from the desert, white desert foxes, baboons that jumped up and down when the sun came, elephant tusks, ostrich eggs, ostrich feathers, more monkeys. And look at this marvel. I bet few Egyptians had ever seen a giraffe, especially one with a monkey on his neck. And look here, a change of pace now, not animals and people from the south, but fair-skinned people, Syrians, Palestinians from the north, elegant men in long white robes, with a baby elephant and a bear from the mountains, and horses too. Syrians brought horses into Egypt, and with them the chariot, the great Egyptian war machine. But the interesting thing about these scenes is that the artist isn't looking down at the people. He's intrigued by them. He doesn't have that modern obsession with race. He could be Egyptian, whether your skin was Syrian white, Nubian black, Libyan with blonde hair, or anything. It didn't matter. All you had to do was to live in the Nile Valley in the right way, put the right clothes on and change your name, and you were Egyptian.
For the most part, then, the harshness and prejudice that the Egyptians show in the Old Testament is not reflected in the reality of the ancient records. Nonetheless, there's a great deal of evidence in the book of Genesis to show that whoever wrote it knew Pharaoh's Egypt and knew it at first hand. Once again, to see evidence of that, you must go into the great tombs of Thebes.
Some of these Egyptian tombs, you have to go right down into the ground, into the burial chamber itself,
to find the finest paintings.
This is the tomb of the mayor of Thebes.
There he is, Mr. Senefer and his wife. But here in the underworld, they're dead, and it's their son who is giving him the offerings. And scenes like this are full of detail, the sort of detail that you find in the Bible stories. The eldest son it is who communes with his dead parents. The eldest son, in fact, communicates with all the ancestors of Egypt. So, for example, when Jehovah smites the eldest son, he's not just killing off a member of the family, he's breaking Egypt's connection with the dead. And that's the sort of link that you find with the Bible stories, with these tombs. You can also find quite interesting direct details of Bible stories, like many other of these wonderful tombs. Senefer's fine paintings are just filled up with little tiny references to Bible stories and Bible things. Look at these figures here. You can see Senefer himself, the grand mayor, high public dignitary, with his wife, and she's offering him a beautiful necklace on a basket. Now, remember the incident in the story of Joseph and Pharaoh. Joseph, who comes, is a Hebrew, and he comes into Egypt, and because of his wonderful telling of dreams, gets to be made the highest official in the land. And Pharaoh says to Joseph, I will give you authority over all the land of Egypt. And what does he give Joseph? He gives him exactly what Senefer, another high official, is wearing. He gives him the seal of the king. He gives them a collar of gold, which you can even find still on mummies. You can see it in x-rays under their bandages. Very common, these great golden collars of the high officials. And he gives him fine linens. Now, this tells you something interesting, else interesting about the Bible. It tells you that the Bible is not only giving you a lot of Egyptian detail, but it's doing that typical biblical thing. It's turning something which is actually a state ceremony, something quite formal, like a knighting or a coronation, into something quite personal. And that, in that way, the Bible is unique in the ancient world. But there's another thing this beautiful tomb can suggest to us. Perhaps it's more important than all those little details that you can read from the tomb to the Bible. And that's something to do with the vision of the people who made the place, the sheer joy of it, the grapevines, the carpets, the lovely, lively painting. It's the work of people who know what paradise is, who live in beautiful circumstances, the sort of thing that you didn't get in the rest of the ancient world. In fact, it's a vision of the land of milk and honey. And perhaps it's the first and original example of that land of milk and honey that the Israelites so desperately wanted for their own.
Ancient Egypt, remember, was the first nation state in all the world. And Egypt, too, was a supreme example of the fruitful unison of men and gods.
Colossal kingdom upon foreigners must have been completely overwhelming. The sheer power, the size, the skill of it all. The pharaoh, above him, the gods, the heavens, beneath him, the people, and then underneath them, the foreigners. Everything has an order and a shape here, and that single shape must have just projected itself upon everybody who came here with its supreme confidence and ability. But there's something more than that here, too, because these palaces and the temples of the gods were private, shut off, dark, secret, mysterious places. Foreigners, most Egyptians, wouldn't have got past the gateway here. Our visitor wouldn't merely have received an impression of this open structured state, but of something mysterious and hidden. And at its center, a oneness of mystery and sacredness, which he would have never have seen. Behind these great walls would have been a power, sort of throbbing away like a nuclear reactor.
This would have been ancient Egypt's greatest gift to Abraham, for it's certainly Egypt's greatest gift to the Old Testament, a vision of a calm and universal holiness. At the heart of the Egyptian temples stood the gods. Their vitality controlled the universe and made Egypt prosper. Though ancient Egypt had 1,000 gods in it, it also held a notion of an underlying holiness that ran deep beneath everything. For thousands upon thousands of years, Egyptian priests had studied and defined this sacred order and developed the ceremonials, the rituals, by which Egypt had become a partner of the gods in a single universal scheme. Ancient Egypt gave the Bible, just as it gave to so much of the ancient world, a special sense of right and ritual, and holiness and deity.
Years ago, one of the greatest cities in the world stood just over these fields here. Just where that road is, there's a little canal. In ancient times, it was one of the main branches of the Nile.
And down it came ships from Cyprus, from Syria, from Crete, all over the Mediterranean, bringing goods, foreign, rare, wonderful things, into the courts of the pharaohs that stood here. Of course, by the canals stood the warehouses. Behind the warehouses, the offices of administration, and then the royal palaces, and then the temples. Clouds of incense going up into the air. Like this town's gone, straight up into the air. Look at this. Aren't they extraordinary? It's a very old pair of feet left in a field. They're about 8 or 10 times bigger than our feet, so the statue must have stood 50, 60 feet high. And then, of course, on top of that, you have a great crown and the pedestal underneath. It must have been a massive statue dragged here from the limestone cliffs of Egypt. And down here in front, it's the name of the man in whose honour the statue was brought here. Usamartra Meriamun, Ramesses II, beloved of the gods. And he called his city Ramesses after him. And this city, the Bible tells us then, is the city of the Exodus. Exodus is simply the Greek word for going out. And of course, the Exodus is the going out of the children of Israel from Egypt to wander in the wilderness for 40 years and then come into their promised land in Israel, the Israelites. Now, Egyptian records tell us that there were already Israelites in their promised land in a particular date. It's a precious record, the only one from ancient Egypt. But there it is, and the date is 1207. At that time, the children of Israel were already in their promised land, according to the ancient Egyptian texts. So, they wandered, as the Bible tells us, for 40 years in the wilderness. They must have started from here, from Ramesses, not later than 1247 BC. That's a pretty precise date, because that is exactly the time when Ramesses was on the throne. And if we take back history a little further, we can see there's about a 30-year period when the Exodus could have occurred, and in the time of Ramesses. Sounds amazingly precise, doesn't it? But there's one problem. Unlike Tel el-Daba, it's the old city under its ash, unlike the palaces here, unlike Ramesses' statue, you can't actually find any archaeological evidence that the Exodus ever took place. In a country where thousands upon thousands of documents have survived, that is very extraordinary. There's not a hint of Israel in Egypt in the ancient texts, nor of the biblical Exodus. In fact, the Exodus never took place in history as the Bible describes it. But then, of course, the truth of the Exodus story, like all truths in the ancient world, is not the sort of truth you'll find in history books. In the 19th century, lots of English vicars used to come to the Sinai Desert to escape the English winter and to look for Moses and the traces of the Exodus. Most of them were only here a few days, of course, before they discovered there was just no way that 600,000 people could survive in this wilderness. There are other problems too. In a place where you can find traces of Bedouin encampments, just two or three people, a state one night thousands of years ago, there was no trace of these 600,000 people. And that's the biggest number of people that have ever been here, apart from the two armies in the recent wars. Then there's another problem, the ancient Egyptian records. There's no record of the quarter of the population of the country ever getting up and leaving, either. Oh, well, say the experts, that's because ancient people generally get the numbers wrong. Let's fine it down. Instead of 600,000, let's call it 5,000. And let's say that the miraculous parting the Red Sea was actually caused by a volcanic explosion that somehow created this enormous tidal wave, and on you go with these explanations. What you end up doing, of course, is translating a marvellous, miraculous event into a banal Bedouin trot through the desert with a few guys wandering around. Of course, the story is not about a documentary about people leaving Egypt. The story is about the birth of a new god and the birth of a new nation. But strangely enough, it's told in the old, old ways of ancient Egypt and Mesopotamia. That is, on the great wave of a myth.
The Exodus story is a remake of some of the East's most ancient tales. That is how the Book of Genesis tells us all its most important things. Ancient Israel knew nothing about science or history books, but it did know the old creation stories, and what, therefore, the creation of ancient Israel must have been like. And that's exactly what the Exodus story is, a creation story. Moses is the Egyptian word for birth. With the parting of the waters of the Red Sea, Israel was born again, just as the world had been made at the time of the creation. And that is the truth of this extraordinary saga.
You know, if you want to, you can explain the whole beautiful story of the Exodus in terms of a volcanic explosion. You can say, for example, that the parting of the Red Sea was due to the after effects of a tidal wave. You can say that Jehovah appearing in a column of fire was the glowing ash of the volcano in the night sky. There was a volcanic explosion like that too, about 1450 BC. But the miraculous thing about that is that not one ancient scribe of that time ever saw fit to write about it. It's not that surprising, actually, because ancient scribes in that time didn't write about things like that. They didn't think they were important enough. So, if that story really is behind the Exodus, what you can say is then that only Moses himself saw God in that cloud and that explosion. And that perception of God, that new understanding, that new awareness of what a God was far more thunderous than any volcanic explosion. Just think about this new God. Just think about Jehovah for a moment. Jehovah travelled with Moses and his people from Egypt to the Promised Land. He wandered with them for 40 years in the wilderness. This Jehovah, then, is a God that moves through space and through time. And that makes him the most revolutionary God that there ever was, that anybody ever saw. Look, the gods of Egypt and Mesopotamia were usually gods of place. They usually stayed in one place. They were gods of the washing or the fields or the rivers or the skies or the mountains or the towns or something like that. They were gods of place, and they were often in families. And as far as time went, they were usually gods of cycles. They were gods of the sun going over every day, or gods of the river flooding every year, or the moon, or things like that. And men moved in those rhythms. Jehovah's not like that, though. He moves through time, with time. Time is now a linear thing like a river, and Jehovah and his people are moving along together. That makes it not only a new idea for God, but a new idea for man and what man can be. And that's the fantastic thing about this God. It actually gives man a new potential. Now he can develop, not over the course of a year and through one harvest, but through centuries, and he can do a deal with God. This amazing, moral, abstract, theological thing, that if he does the right thing, he will get better and better and better as the millennia go by. What an extraordinary new God, then. So, think of the Bible now. Think of the gods of Mesopotamia that have given the Book of Genesis its universe, its order, its stage on which all the rest of the Bible is set. And the gods of Egypt, who gave, really, I suppose they gave Jehovah something of his power and majesty, something of that secret quality. But it's only this new God of space and time, which is in Israel. And that's the God that is still with us and our civilization today.